Good morning. It's a pleasure being here today. I'd just like to talk about how much Aretha and I are really enjoying the things on the internet, the messages that Pastor Mike brings, Pastor Blaze, Pastor Bob, and Jim Burns even. And we really appreciate all these messages. We take it to heart. We just love the Lord, and we just look forward to these messages each and every week. And also the singing, Christy Lee, all the people who have times that they sing in church, and Brian, who backs up with the guitar. We enjoy his music too. One thing that I think about is our church. A lot of people just think of a church and no further, but God preaches throughout the whole world, missionaries and so forth, and we're all having these problems where we might not be able to be in our services like we want to be, but we're just leaving it up to God. And we figured, a lot of people think, oh, we're only a drop in a bucket. That might be true, but all the drops in a bucket is what fills the water up and so forth. And we just know the Lord's going to see us through the whole thing. And God bless you.
Thank you. God of this city, you're the king of these people, you're the lord of this nation. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the king of these people, you're the lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are.
continuing today on the series, on the Overcoming series. Today I want to talk to you about overcoming the flesh. The passage is in Galatians chapter 5. We're going to begin at verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, and orgies, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in past times, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. You know, the Bible describes and prescribes an overcoming, victorious lifestyle. I mean, we're to be more than conquerors, saved to the uttermost, crucified to the world, sanctified, ready for the Master's use, a vessel unto honor. We're to have the same obedient, servant-hearted attitude as Jesus had. We're to have clean hands and a pure heart, filled with the Holy Spirit, loving God with our whole heart and our neighbors, ourselves, even praying for those who despitefully use us. We're to exude joy unspeakable and full of glory while maintaining a growing hunger to know Jesus more. You know, I realize that some misunderstand and place this wonderful experience in the impossible category. But I'm praying for you to consider these scriptures and have a breakthrough. Remember, a breakthrough is a moment in time when the impossible becomes possible. It is impossible with man, but all things are possible with God. And this is all due to what Jesus did at the cross, what he suffered and died there for us, and his resurrection power, which the Bible says is working in us. So what is this flesh? What is this worldliness, you might call it, because it's similar throughout the scripture? Well, let me give you a few things that maybe you can look at and talk about. Let's make a difference between what the flesh is and what is fleshly. In other words, what the world is and what is worldliness. The world is physical, created by God. But the worldliness is a spiritual or a philosophy, a way that we approach things. For example, Jesus says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life." Then in 1 John, John tells the church, "Do not love the world or anything that's in the world." And so which one are we supposed to do? Well, obviously, when we talk about the world, we're talking about, or the flesh, the Bible sometimes refers to, is the creation of God. In other words, those human beings that are populating the planet. When we talk about the world or the flesh, we're talking about the creation of God. We talk about worldliness, we're talking about the corruption of sin. When we talk about the world, we're talking about is what is redeemable. When we're talking about worldliness, we're talking about what is abominable. So flesh, just by its existence, nature, is associated with the external appearance. That external appearance is passing away and will not be eternal. The lust or the desire of the flesh is for the things that are temporal and not eternal, not eternally significant, but are more in opposition to the way and the plan of God for us. So you might see it in varying terms throughout the Bible or even Christian literature. Sometimes we refer to it as inbred or original sin, sometimes depravity, sometimes the polluted nature or corruption of the flesh. self, the sin which so easily besets us, the sin that remains in the believer, the indwelling sin or moral inability or instability. James calls it being double-minded. So we understand the difference between the two when we're talking about human relationships. Just think of some of the entertainment, some of the songs that are now popular and out on the radio or when you hear your music. Listen to this one. It says, "I'm in love with the shape of you." Very externally motivated. That's what it is. He's not interested in their relationship. He just loves the physical appearance of this lady. If you go back a couple of decades, you'll remember a guy singing a song that says, "I want your sex." That's what it was about. If you think about this country song a couple of decades ago came out, and he addressed this. It was Randy Travis when he said, "They say time takes its toll on a body, makes a young girl's brown hair turn gray. Well, honey, I don't care. I ain't in love with your hair. And if it all fell out, well, I'd love you anyway." That sounds like a more of a staying kind of constant relationship. Or another one who said, "I cross my heart and I promise to make all your dreams and wishes come true. In all the world, you'll never find a love as true as mine." When we talk about somebody having a beautiful mind, we're not talking about the shape of their brain. We're talking about the way they think, their philosophy, what they go about. We're talking about somebody who has a good heart. We're not talking about being plaque-free and arteries pumping full speed. We're talking about the enduring qualities of love, of generosity, and of righteousness that come into a person's life and they exude out of them. So since this is described as a principle or philosophy to be free from in the Scripture, does the Bible give us any hope that we could ever be delivered from this spiritual flesh that it talks about? Or is God just giving us these commands and then leaving us to our own devices to figure it out? If that's the case, then a lot of people have already written it off because they've said that's impossible. I can't do that. The only one perfect is Jesus. He's the only one ever lived perfectly. Understand, we're talking about the flesh. We're not talking about your performance. We're talking about a series of philosophies and beliefs that you tell yourself that cause you to sin or to go towards sinning. So when we talk about that, does it give us any deliverance from that, or is God just trying to frustrate us? He didn't say, try to be holy because I'm holy. He said, you be holy because I'm holy. It's not a multiple choice. It's not like we have a possibility of watering it down. If it's not possible, God would not have put it in the Bible. If it were not possible, he wouldn't have commanded it. He expects it, and he provides a way for it. That's the good news. That's what the death on the cross, when Jesus died on the cross, was all about, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Hebrew writer reminds us he is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him. He suffered outside the city gates that he might sanctify the people with his own blood. When we think about what he did there, he took out a stony heart and put in a soft heart in us. Well, I'd have to ask, are there any others who can witness to this? Is there anybody who's had that kind of experience and that I can look at and see in the Scripture? Well, Paul said it this way in the second chapter of this book of Galatians. He said, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I am now living in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." So Paul said, "I am living in the flesh. I am in this world, not gone to heaven yet. I am suffering through all the same things I've always suffered through in life, and yet I have this experience of being crucified with Christ." Obviously, he's not talking about the physical flesh. He's talking about that nature that causes us to want to go against God. So if that's what God is giving us a deliverance from, obviously Jesus did enough on the cross to provide that. One of the ways, and when you think about it, I read a book called Witnesses of the Way. And almost every denominational leader in history has given witness to an experience like this. It was supernatural. It was beyond what they could do. Even those who created doctrines or teaching methods that didn't include this, they still experienced it. So how can I experience it? How can you? How can we walk in the Spirit and therefore not fulfill the desires of the flesh? How can we overcome the flesh? Well, there are three steps, I believe, that will help you. In closing, I want to talk to you about. The first is, it's got to be an all-in type of thing. You need to consecrate your entire self. Jesus put it this way, with all my heart, mind, soul, body, and strength. So I'm not holding anything back. I'm just telling God, you can have every part of me. I'm an open book. I'm all open to whatever you want me to do and however you want to move in my life. The second step is pretty easy too. And that is just to ask. He says you have not because you ask not. I'm surprised at how many Christians want to live a consecrated life, but they've not asked God to cleanse them and give them that power to live a Spirit-filled life. You can't walk in the Spirit unless the Spirit is indwelling you completely. And the third thing is that I want to put my faith in the promise of God. Now, Paul makes a big deal of that here in Galatians in the earlier parts of this book, and he says there are two different ways people try to please God. One of those ways is when we try to do it in our own strength. We try to obey all the laws. We try to do all cross all our T's, dot all our I's. We think we can somehow impress God with our goodness or our good deeds. He said there's another group who trust and believe that God will bless and give them a standing that they need, not based on their works, but based on their faith that God is faithful and He will do what He promised. That's the group you want to be in. Let me share this promise from Paul. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. May God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and He will do it. The only way to overcome the flesh is to ask Him to do it. You can consecrate all day, and you can ask all day, but your faith has to be in the one who promised. And Paul reassures us, He will do it. So when we meet those prerequisites or guidelines that He set up, and we're trusting, we believe that He will come and help us, He certainly does. He will cleanse the motives of your mind and your heart. He will fill you with a power that only the Holy Spirit supernatural to help you be what God wants you to be. Really, all of Christianity should be about that. Because we're not saved just to get us out of hell. Not saved just to get out of hell free card so that someday when we meet God, He will forgive all of our past. God put things in you that are good. God gave you gifts and abilities and strength and influence that will win the world for Him, that will cause others to be influenced for the gospel, for God Himself will use you. But not unless you're walking in the Spirit, not unless you're letting the Holy Spirit direct your life. And since the flesh is contrary to the Spirit, He gives you a way to get rid of that. He's a good God. He's got more in store for you than you understand or know at this point. And it just keeps unfolding and unfolding and unfolding, and it keeps getting better and better. So as your pastor, I want to encourage you. Pray that prayer. Believe what God's promised, and let Him do the work in your heart to get you overcoming flesh as well. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that each person that's listening today, everybody who's hearing this video, that they will come to you and say, this is the kind of life you made me for. This is what I want. And I would consecrate 1,000 lives if I could, just to have your will done in me. Will you come and fulfill what you had in mind when you created me this way? Give glory to your name. And we ask it in the strong name of Jesus, who made it possible on the cross. Amen.
He has come to bring light into the darkness. He has come to bring freedom to the captives. He has come to restore the broken heart. It's time to proclaim the year of the Lord. Prepare the way. Prepare the way for our Redeemer. Prepare the way. Prepare the way for our Restorer. Make ready your heart. Make ready your home. Make ready the people of God. Prepare the way. To comfort all who mourn, He has come to heal our every sickness. It's time to proclaim the year of the Lord. Prepare the way. Prepare the way for our Redeemer. Prepare the way. Ready the people of God. Prepare.